Welcome to the D3 Talks at Fashion Forward. Tonight we're covering a topic which is fundamental to the success of any business, how to fund your business. But I think particularly for the fashion industry, it's been one that we've had a wide gap where creatives and investors have a hard time coming together. And we hope to change that a little tonight. We have a group of panelists that really know their stuff. We're very lucky to have them here. We're going to start this evening with Amjad Ahmed. Amjad is the founder and managing partner of Precinct Partners. He has a deep knowledge and experience in the industry, starting his career in the private equity world in the region and then moving into venture capital. He works very closely with founders of company to improve their businesses, optimize them, and make money for his investors. We're lucky to have him here tonight. We're going to talk about everything from how do you approach an investor, how to pitch, and then we're going to move on to talk with one of Amjad's investees and learn more about that experience.
Yes, great. Thanks, Amjad. Thank you. You're too kind. Hello, everybody. Good evening. I'm very excited to be here today. Usually when I do these talks, it's a group of grumpy old men with gray suits giving me very menacing looks. So it's nice to be in front of a very creative and fashionable crowd. So today, what I want to do is I want to talk to you more about the investor perspective so you better understand how to craft your story when you're looking for funding. Funding is the lifeblood, of course, of any business. And I think it's good to hear our perspective so you understand better what we look for when we look at businesses such as yours. So generally, we look at five main categories, very broad categories. One is team. Second is sector. Third is market. Fourth is business model. And the last is what stage of development your company is in. So moving to the first one, the team. This is very important, and I think specifically for creative businesses where you might be strong in one area, it's very important that you supplement yourself with a very strong team that helps you and complements you in areas that you might not be so strong. So by show of hands, I'm going to ask you if you know these people and let me know. Sergio Galati. No one knows who that is. Okay. Steve Wozniak. The Woz. Damn it, I knew that one you guys would know. Okay, the last one is Robert Duffy. Oh, one person. Okay, great. So, without these three people, you would have never heard of Steve Jobs. You would have never heard of Giorgio Armani. And you would have definitely never heard of Marc Jacobs. So, these three men were their business partners for each one of them probably 30, 40 years. And really helped them develop their business. So while they were very creative, they sort of left the other areas of developing the company to these three great operators. So as you think about the team, the founding team is very important. Many of you might be alone right now, but I think you should really consider finding someone else that can sort of partner on this journey with you, specifically if you feel that there are other areas where you're not as strong. I think advisors are critical at an early stage. People in the industry, people outside of the industry, people that you really trust and believe in their opinion. Board of directors is also important to develop at some stage, maybe not so early on, but as you progress. Investors. So most of you just want the cash. You don't really care about who the investor is. But actually, you should care. Because a good investor can actually take you a long way. And I think Kunal can talk to you about different types of investors and who can help, who cannot help. But I think a really good investment team can help the company develop and can actually be an extension of who you are and your founding group. Now, management team are those beyond the founders. So as you develop the company, you have to develop people and you have to develop a management team. And different phases of the company require different skill sets. So it's very important that you look for these people, you start sort of bringing them up the organization and so on and so forth. So I'm a big believer in the next one, stock options. Don't be greedy. Don't try to keep 100% of the company. share, get alignment with others that share your vision and that are taking this journey with you. They have to share in the wealth. And last but not least, you've heard this word a lot, culture. You have to build a great culture because teams build companies, not individuals. So moving on to sector, think of sector as the field you're playing in. Is it a tennis court? Is it a football pitch? That's the sector, okay? So which area of fashion are you gonna focus on? There are a lot of ways you can think about sectors, but I like to think of it in a very simple format, which has worked for me. We have market share on one side. Market share, all it means is how much an individual player has. They have 10% of the market, 5% of the market, 20% of the market. The other is market growth. Is the market growing by 1% or 20%, okay? So let's start with the easy one, the dogs. These are companies we never touch, okay? So these are sectors that are, you know, low growth, and there's a lot of fragmentation. What that usually tells you is it's very hard to differentiate yourself. So a lot of these companies tend to be dogs. You don't want a good company in a bad sector. You want a good company in a great sector. On the flip side, you have companies that, sectors that have players who are dominant, they have a big market share, and the sector is growing very fast. So think of eyewear. Luxottica owns the market there, and it continues to grow double digits every year. So that's that type of market or sector. The one on the cash cows are like utilities. They're sectors that have matured, low growth, but there are some dominant players in this sector. Okay, so jeans can be one of these, right? There are a couple of big players in jeans. The jean category might not be growing so much. Luxury jeans is, but not the low-end jeans. So this could be that type of sector. Now, the one I love and where you can do really well are sectors that are growing very fast, but there are no clear winners yet because it's too early. So if you back the right people, you can eventually end up owning some stars. And I promise this is my only plug for the Luxury Closet, but this is the sector that the Luxury Closet is playing in. So this is the pre-owned luxury goods sector. I see that as this type of sector. Now, market effectively means the pool of customers that you're going after, okay? What we wanna know is that it's a large group of people. Why? Because it's just easier to do business that way. It's easier to have winners in that kind of segment. And that it's growing, okay? So when you pitch, a lot of times people are very unclear about who their addressable market is. And I think the worst pitch in the world is, I cater to everyone. So try not to do that. So you wanna be very, very specific. And the more data you have here, the more I think will be better for you. We're very data-driven, right? So are you going after local customers or regional customers? How large is that? What does it look like? Young or old? You know, this list can go on to many things. Are you after a niche product or a mass product? You know, niche businesses are fantastic. Some of them work really well. So you don't always have to go for mass. Sorry, this is a bit slow. Low-end or high-end? So are you going after luxury or are you going for something low cost? Consumer or business? Some of you might be targeting businesses, not necessarily consumers, which again changes the dynamic of how I look at that business. And then last but not least, are you looking at sort of a brick and mortar or digital? Those are very different markets. You might be looking at both. The point is to be clear. Now, the next one is business model. And I think 90% of entrepreneurs fail on business model. There are many people with great ideas. We all have them all the time, but execution is very different. So I think this is the area where you really have to sit down and figure out, how am I gonna bring my product to market? What is my pricing strategy? What's my customer acquisition strategy? This is really the detail. This is the nuts and bolts of it all. So, as you think about your co-founders, many of you are designers and creative people who may be not so great at this, you might want to supplement your team with people who are excellent at this type of approach. Those three people we mentioned are effectively people who are geniuses at doing this. I put an example here because I wanted to sort of bring this to life. So when you think about business model, these two companies were chasing the same exact market, same exact sector. One went out of business, the other one is thriving, right? So your business model and how you deliver makes a big impact on your success. Now, the stage of company is, again, one of those points that you really need to figure out before you approach investors, because I might have a very different risk appetite than another company, okay? So wasting your time with companies that only focus on mature businesses, that have revenue, if you're just a seed stage company, just doesn't make a lot of sense. So as you think about this, I try to really make it easy here. So if you look at the risk-reward, right? You have high risk, low risk, time, and then value. So as you develop your company, your risk gets reduced, right? And hopefully your value goes up. And that's how investors look at it. So some investors only invest in that later stage, and some don't mind the risk, and they invest in the earlier stage. And some of this has rough numbers. It's not exact, but if you're thinking about pre-seed and seed, it's usually you're looking to raise sub-$1 million. That's where you are in your development. And then you get into venture, which is a few million dollars. And again, this is very localized. I think if you go to the US, these numbers would be a lot bigger. But this is more our region. And then, of course, you get to the private equity stage, which, you know, requires more capital. So each one of these, depending on where you are, you will target a completely different investor, okay? So early stage, you're going to target people like incubators, accelerators, angels, friends and family. Those are the best people to approach when starting a business, okay? We have some now in the region, and they're picking up. Not so many for design, unfortunately, but I think we'll see that develop. But I think here, you're really looking for people who know you intimately, because they're the backers. They're the people who are going to back you initially because they know you, they trust you, they believe in your ideas. Then once you get out of this stage and your product is developed and you have some market acceptance, then I think you come to people like us, right? So venture and growth investors. We are okay with that sort of type of risk. So your company by now is a little bit set up. You have some revenues, you have some indication that the market has accepted your product, and you say, okay, now I need a big round to sort of get me to the next level. And this is where you want to start thinking about the type of investors you want to bring on board, because they can help you, again, go to the next stage. Now, hopefully a lot of you will get to the next stage after that, which is really where the private equity groups come in, larger checks, the company's mature, it's profitable, and so on and so forth. So two quick examples of companies that went through this journey. I don't know if you know this company, Warby Parker. I love it. I'm a customer myself. So very simple idea. They said eyewear is growing fast. It's dominated by one group that charges a ton of money for glasses that cost nearly nothing. So we're going to produce our own glasses. We're going to design them, and we're going to send them direct to the consumer. And that's exactly what they did. So simple, but execution-wise, they did a fantastic job. So as you can see, they went through multiple rounds. You know, initially, their friends and family backed them very early on. They ended up getting a little bit of VC money. And if you see the type of investors as they went on this journey, you would see very different names later than earlier. Okay, and that's very natural. But what you see here is that it's a process. You're constantly raising money. So this is an important part of growing your business. And now the company's worth $1.2 billion, they have 100 employees, and it's still growing very fast. The next example I want to give you is Bonobos. So again, very simple. Men's khakis used to fit horribly, so they said, we're going to build a better khaki pant. And that's what they did. It was one product. And again, what they did was they came online first, and then they went offline. I want to mention something about that. We're living in a time where you as entrepreneurs are so lucky, because starting a business today costs a fraction of what it did even 5 years ago. So there are a lot of things you can do to start a business today on a very low budget. So when you think about growing your business, you have to be creative about grabbing these opportunities that exist in terms of outsourcing and other things that you can do to sort of leverage your business very early on. This company, by the way, was acquired by Walmart earlier this year for $310 million. So again, another success story. I want to end off with this quote, because I think it encapsulates what it means to be an entrepreneur and sort of the essence of entrepreneurship. So what this says basically is, never be satisfied, always strive to make yourself better, and don't let anyone tell you that you can't do it. Okay? Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Amjad. I think there's so much more that we want to tap from you and learn from you. And to do that, I'm going to invite to the stage two people who have worked with you. Well, one who has worked with you and one who's going to get a little bit more out of both of you. You mentioned the luxury closet, one of the big, hot, up-and-coming, underserved markets. The luxury closet, many of you may know, is basically a place to buy beautiful luxury goods that have been pre-loved. And it was started by Kunal, who had a very innovative idea to do something in this region that hadn't been done the way he's done it in a very digital format. So Kunal has also been funded by Precinct Partners. Amjad was a very early believer in the idea, so we can talk through some of that. And to carry on the conversation, we have Sarah Hamdan. Sarah has been covering the startup ecosystem in the region for some time for the New York Times. She's an editor with Think at Google MENA, and she knows a lot about this region. So thank you. Over to you.
Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. How are you? How are you guys?
Hello.
I'm really excited to be here tonight, because this is the kind of information that people usually pay to hear. And as much as we all love fashion, we're here for Fashion Forward. It's all about creative expression and being artistic. At the end of the day, success is usually measured with dollar signs. So we need to know a little bit about the business side of things, and that's where these guys have done it so well. We're lucky to have both ends of the spectrum as well. So we have Amjad, which is the VC, the funding side. He's the one who gives the money. And we have the successful startup side, and that's where Kunal comes in with the luxury closet, which is pre-loved goods. Ritu gave a great introduction to all of us. So, you know, luxury closet, Kunal, Precinct Partners, Amjad, and I'm Sarah Hamdan. I covered the startup scene for the New York Times for 6 years, and now I work for Google part-time, and I have a travel blog called Holidays in Heels, and I love to moderate anything that has to do with startups, because it's very, very passionate, and people really put their soul into it. So I just wanted to start off with a really simple question of, let's say you are a great designer and you love fashion, but you're not good at numbers. What do you do? Do you hire somebody to deal with that for you, or do you just suck it up and learn it? What did you do?
Before I start off, just to make sure I tailor my answers. Hello? Is that better? Okay, that's better? Okay, cool. I want to tailor my answers. So can I just do a super quick poll? All right, so who here wants to be an entrepreneur? But it's not already an entrepreneur. Who wants to be an entrepreneur? And you're not already an entrepreneur. Okay. Who is here is already an entrepreneur, but their company is less than 10 people? Okay. Who here is an entrepreneur, but their company is more than 10 people? All right. Perfect, thanks. That's a great audience. So we focus on,
And who here is a designer or interested in fashion and knows nothing about the business side? Everybody's hands up.
That's a good question. Just to answer that question, I think I was, I'm a slightly odd one out, because when I was in college, I studied photography. And on the other end, I took computer science classes. So I was like the only nerd in the photography studio. So that kind of helped me out. Because I could do a fair bit of numbers. But I think the better example is like my sister. And my sister is a wannabe fashion entrepreneur, and she doesn't know any numbers, so she gives her numbers to me. My advice for her is always, you need to know your numbers. So I know that you might have to bend backwards, do a backflip, but you need to know your numbers. The number of people that I see get stuck or not move forward or not grow just because they lack really basic number skill is far too many. I think that it's something that you cannot absolutely depend on everybody else for, so go learn some maths.
But before the Luxury Closet, you started a shoe design company you were telling me about. So in that case, when things are at the very, very beginning, if you weren't comfortable with numbers, do you hire somebody or do you just do it yourself?
So I would say that the startup world, or like when you're starting a business, is full of people who want to help you. There's a lot of people who want to help you. So if you don't think there's anybody who wants to help you, just haven't asked. So you should actually go and ask somebody. So you need to find somebody who will help do the numbers for you. So for example, just to give you our perspective, so we ran a basic, fairly basic model, 20 Excel pages into one model. That was fairly basic for us. Then we went to a private equity fund and we said, listen, this would be a great opportunity for you to look at this business. They looked at our model and they said, oh, you don't know what you're doing. We'll build the model for you, right? And then somebody spent an entire month trying to build our model just to help us. So
that's great. So always ask for help. I think that's a pretty good life motto. And Amjad, is this the first time that you invest in a fashion startup specifically? Have you done it before? And what made them stand out for you?
Yes, I mean, yes, in terms of fashion, yes. We also have Mom's World, which also sells
sort
of things for babies. But this is the first time we've invested in sort of a fashion platform.
Yeah. And what made them stand out for you?
So a couple of things. I think one is, if you remember the chart about the sectors, you know, I'm a big believer that the sharing economy is upon us, and that people are going to start figuring out more and more ways to share things. And I think one way is used goods. We all have closets that have things that we don't wear, and you always think to yourself, you know, what do I do with this? So I'll give you my example. I had about 100 Hermes ties, you know, because I used to wear a lot of Hermes ties when you work on Wall Street. So what did I do? I actually put them on the Luxury Closet, and now I'm getting some money for them. So otherwise they were just sitting in my drawer, and that's a true story. So I think what
I saw.
If you're
looking to send anyone a Christmas present.
Yes, if you'd like one, I'll happily give you one. So I thought that this market was definitely going to develop. It's definitely going to grow. There are no clear winners yet. You know, Luxury Closet was a first mover. Kunal had this great idea a while ago. He went through that hard work of establishing the business. So I felt like I was backing the champion, the eventual champion of this sector. So that's why I decided to invest. You know,
when you heard the idea, it wasn't necessarily that it dealt with fashion and that was new, but more the shared economy, and
yes,
that's what
yes.
appealed to you.
That was one, but the other thing is, if you think about our region and luxury here, we are sitting on one of the highest spend per capita on luxury in the world, in the Middle East.
The highest.
So that tells you something. It tells you that there's a lot of supply. People are buying a lot of luxury, and it's going to have to channel somewhere. And they're going to continue to buy it, right? So they're going to have to do something with all those used goods that they have. But I want to hit on something that he talked about, which is the modeling and all of that. That was one thing that really got me over the initial sort of trepidation of investing in this type of business, is that he really knew the detail.
So we're talking about financial modeling here.
Yes,
so
yes.
So the projections and look, of how much they expect to make in sales and that kind of thing, not like Carly Kloss.
And look, I think sometimes people think it's just about math. It's not about math. It's the financial model leads to your business model, which is, what is your customer acquisition cost? Does it make sense? If you're selling a t-shirt for $10, but your customer acquisition cost is $20, you're losing $10 on every shirt that you sell. So getting to that level of detail helps an investor understand how you're actually going to monetize. Because at the end of the day, you know, to be very blunt, we're not a philanthropy, right? I'm not a philanthropist. We want to make money, and we want to help them make money, right? So you have to sort of articulate how your design and your great ideas are going to eventually get to creating a $310 million business, right? And I think that's what the numbers are all about.
Okay, so what does the fashion e-commerce scene look like now? Do you feel like there are a lot of players? Has it grown since the time when you first launched? Where are we now in MENA?
So I think that there was like a first wave, and the first wave was Sukkar and Marka VIP.
Yeah.
Just in the same period of time, there was also Namshi. Now, Namshi is the most successful, according
to
me, fashion
story.
Business in the region. Not
Who
only
here
is
has
it
bought
the most
clothes off Namshi? I have.
So not only is the most successful fashion business in the region, it's the best run e-commerce company that I have personally witnessed. They have amazing metrics. It's not just like fashion, of course, like all rocket internet businesses, it stands out as an outlier. So they've managed to build what is now maybe $200 million, $300 million of sales within the region, with all of the, you know, the complexity of the region, which is cash on delivery, barriers to selling in other countries. It's not one economy, it's like so many countries. So they've managed to do it, so I think that's that. I think the next wave is the luxury closet, and there's a few more companies. I think I'm just mentioned Mom's World. It's not fashion commerce, but nonetheless it's e-commerce, and you'll see some of these companies become as large as Namshi.
I mean, I have some insight into what I've been seeing. So there are companies coming up, Warby Parker type of companies coming up. There are some fashion brands, by the way, that have already started in the region. Some targeting sort of low-end fashion, some high-end fashion, and this is direct-to-consumer, where the designer decided to build a website, and they're going direct to the consumer. And I do think that's the next wave. We will have brands that come out of the region, and that's going to be very interesting and exciting. But again, I think you have to be very focused about who you're targeting. And we will see that. You know, we will see great brands for women, we'll see great brands for men, and so on and so forth.
You mentioned earlier that there is big consumer demand, so we're always hungry for more and the next trendy thing.
Yes.
So with something that's so dynamic like that, how can you measure long-term success? So if I'm a new designer and I have three successful collections in a row, what's to guarantee for an investor like you that my 10th collection will also be amazing?
So that's a great question, and I think
it was actually your question earlier. Yeah. I have to give him the credit for that.
the reason I say it's a great question is because, and Ritu asked me to talk about this point. The reason why I think designers and fashion businesses have such a tough time getting funding is because we're afraid of the volatility that design has. And what I mean by volatility is you might come up with one great line, but then we don't know, well, how are you gonna keep that up? You know, you came up with this great t-shirt, but are you gonna come up with another one next year? And we just don't know. It's hard for us to sort of grapple with that. So when you approach investors about your fashion business, I think it's very important to, again, highlight the people who are supplementing you that will help you bring this product to market and make you continue that success. Two is, and I know you're not gonna like this, is how to institutionalize the design part of it. Because it cannot rely on one person. That's not a business that we would like to invest in. You know, you get hit by a bus tomorrow, the label is gone, right? So, and I know that early stage, of course, it's gonna depend on you, but When you articulate your vision, you're gonna have to explain how you're gonna institutionalize that. You know, how are you gonna bring on others that help with the design and that help create these lines, and so on and so forth.
How are you going to make it a business
that's
managing rather than just a brand?
Right, and that's why creative businesses scale.
Maybe I can take that and put into like words that I think like institutionalizing might be like a bit hard to understand. So, I like to say like startups are based on like a lean approach. So it's build, measure, learn. So you build something, you do something, you measure what happened, and then you learn, and then actually you scale what you learned. So if you were successful, you need to find out what it is that you were successful about. And that thing has to be, it has to be replicable. And you have to be able to scale it. And so that's essentially what is out. So if you find something that is successful and has a big core market, that's essentially what you need. So you don't want to sell, I don't know, or you need to think about something in a slightly
but
different way.
But it's tough because when you're starting out and you're excited, you think everyone's also going to be excited by your great idea or your brand, and you do believe that it is scalable. So I feel like sometimes, even
yes.
from you know the point
but
of view
that
of the startup,
early adopters can tell you a lot, right? So if you, like our journey is like, you know, what Amjad showed, we've been through a lot of that. We've been through like one person company started out of like, I mean, the luxury closet was my wife's closet. She's right there, and that was the closet, right? The first website was built on WordPress, and I built it myself. The first website had a cartoon, I would like to say, selling a Louis Vuitton bag, and people bought it. It was not the same level as it is now. But there were adopters, and honestly, the adopters, the early adopters' attraction is normally stronger than the attraction that you will see when you start going to mass market. And it's the same for Careem. I actually asked the founders of Careem the same question, and I think their early adopter group was like 2x or 3x in terms of lifetime value as the later group.
For people who don't know, early adopter
is somebody who is who will adopt your service early, even though your service or your product is not very well developed.
So your mom.
Sorry.
Your mom.
Your mom, right? And if you look at on YouTube there's an amazing short video clip which is from Jeff Bezos, and it's the timing of it is when they acquired
Washington Post.
Sorry.
Washington Post.
Diapers.com?
No. The Zappos.com.
Zappos.
Yeah.
And he talks about the early adopters of Amazon, and they were all actually the families. And they remember the first order.
Yeah, well,
that
I'm glad
received.
You brought that up, actually, because I was going to bring it up from the funder perspective. So normally when you're a startup, the first people that you turn to for money are actually the people around you, your family and friends. Do you see, was that the case kind of for you? I mean, did you?
Yeah, as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, so our first seed round was $220,000. And the first check came from my friend who was share certificate number two. I went to tell her my idea, and I was like, hey, Bianca, you know, I have a great idea. And then she came with a checkbook. but she didn't show
it's
me the checkbook. The checkbook was like in her bag. And then I kept on talking about it, and then she kept on writing. I was like, why are you writing? I'm telling you my idea. And she's like, no, keep on telling me. And then she was like, well, what do you need? And I was like, I don't know, I'm looking for like $10,000 or $20,000 from a person. And then she's like, okay, here's $20,000. And I was like, you're joking with me. She's like, no, it's okay. I believe in this. And it's out of the $220,000.
So basically have good rich friends
Have rich friends.
And then you have a track record, and then you'll go to someone like Amjad to raise more money.
Yeah.
So at what stage would a company come to you to ask for more? And typically how much value would they expect to get?
So I think we like to see that there's a product already developed, that there are some early adopters and people who are willing to pay for it, right?
So you have to have proof that
you're
selling.
Yeah, proof of concept. Yes.
Proof of concept.
So we wouldn't come too early, as in pre-seed where you just have a business plan, and even seed when you're just sort of trying to figure it out. So we would come a bit later. And that's why I always say, I think in the beginning, the best thing to do is to look at the groups that do this type of stuff, which are the incubators, the accelerators, and friends and family, really, and people who really believe in your talent. That's who should be your funder. You know, when you look at the US, VCs only they only invest about 3-4%. When they look at startups, it's only 3-4% that they actually back. So there are a host of startups that start without these professional investors. And it's usually through these other channels.
So basically keep your day job until your startup.
Yeah,
I mean, or actually don't keep your day job, because I that's sometimes my advice as well. I have friends who kept their day jobs until the start of the company, and I would just say, man, just make the plunge, just quit and just do it.
Because otherwise you treat it like a hobby.
But don't laze around. I mean, if you're going to quit and do it, just do it. Like, don't sit around and say, oh, I'm going to do this. No,
you have to be really self-motivated, yeah, I think.
No, but to this point, I think, you know, let's say you jump ship. You know, we've seen a lot of startups who are very creative about the people they work with. So you mentioned, who would you go to do accounting or whatever? I think, you know, I've seen guys who have a CFO, and the CFO is still working, right? But at night, he's working on the financial model of the company. So, and that's fine. You know, I think, you know, early on, that's absolutely fine. You know, using part-timers, using your friend who's a really good financial guy, using your friend who's a really good marketeer, that's okay, you know? But I think there is a point where people have to sort of take that leap. But there's a lot of great ways you can leverage early on.
Kunal, you brought up a really interesting point earlier about your website and how at the beginning it was WordPress and it wasn't where it is today. So many of today's fashion commerce businesses are based on just pure online. There's no brick and mortar store, or even taking it back a notch, they're just selling their designs through Instagram, let's say. So I wanted to get your thoughts on that and just how important it is to have very clear, you know, a great website, good product selection, all of that.
So
the importance
of building
the right site.
I just had a very similar conversation with somebody, and so this is somebody who built a range of products, was in a retail store, and then said, okay, I'm gonna, you know, sell this on the website. And where they got stuck was that first is, they couldn't tell, they said, I don't have sales. I'm like, why don't you have sales? I don't know, right? So the first is that whenever you move online, you need to get a very basic Google Analytics setup. It's GA is free, and you just get somebody to make sure that you do, or you find a platform that syncs in automatically. And you need to be able to
I'm obviously very pro Google products, so continue. Tell them about Google Analytics.
So this is the first. The second is that it's a different skill set, so it's a slightly different kind of business. Equally complex as retail, if not more complex. And you'll need those skill sets, right? So the second question is, I said, okay, why are people not coming to my site? How do I get more people to my site? I said, all right, find a freelancer digital marketing expert. We started with spending $5 on Facebook a day.
Yeah, you can easily do these things online at a cheap cost.
Yeah, absolutely. We started at $5 a day. Mm-hmm. And that $5 became a few thousand dollars a day, but literally $5 a day. That's where we started.
And do you have thoughts on that, just in terms of when you are looking at a company, if you see that their online presence isn't where it should be, does that deter you from investing in them?
Not at all. I mean, the whole point of making these investments is that you see gaps that either you believe you can help them fill, or that they will eventually, with your money and your advice, fill those gaps. So, actually, I love businesses where there are some good elements, but there are some holes.
Yeah.
Because that's where the value is, right? So there's nothing wrong with that. It doesn't have to be perfect, and it will never be perfect. So
you have to try.
It's not a deterrent at all.
Good. I'd love to take some questions from the audience. I feel like we have two experts in the field here, and I don't want to hog them all to myself. Does anybody have a question to ask? Yeah, go ahead.
Good evening.
There's a microphone coming to you.
Good evening. First of all, I'd like to say thank you so much for your time. It's great to have experts in the field. Learned a lot in the few minutes I've been here.
Thanks for coming.
Thank you. I just have a few questions. First is about that. You mentioned something about waves. You said at first it was Markup VIP, and then I remember Markup VIP, and for some reason, I don't know if they're still here. I just wanted to ask, what are your comments on, we've seen Noon.com. I want to see, why do you think that's happening now? Why do you think, it's to both of you actually, why do you think the big guys at Alibaba have decided to put their money into e-commerce now, and why did it happen the way it did? Why, you know, and where does that leave you, Kunal, with Luxury Closet? How does that affect you? I mean, there's Unas on one side, there's also Nas with different price points, the same in the luxury market. What are your thoughts, and what do you see happening in the next few months?
So the question is about the fashion e-commerce landscape and the success stories in the past. So a little bit more on where we are now.
So I'll start. Actually, this is a great question, because the point, my answer, the single most important point you need to get out of it is that it's an amazing time to build an online business, okay? I'm not sure there'll be a better time. If you want to do it, you start tomorrow, okay? That's what you should do. So my explanation to this is that you have to understand that in the region, the amount of spend that is done online versus offline, I think we're at like 2-3%.
That's it.
2-3%. I think the United Kingdom is at 20%. So $20 out of every $100 goes online. And we're at a few percentage points, right? It cannot stay a few percentage points. So the last big economy that I can think of that went through this change is India. Right, so India was the same. There was massive internet penetration because of smartphones. There was a lot of also just no infrastructure to actually grow the retail business. So there was endemic problems in there as well. Then comes e-commerce, and it builds there's three or four companies that SoftBank has invested into. The online space is going to grow. A lot of the growth that is going to come in the market is going to come from the online space, and this is specifically true for retail business. So luxury declined last year, and what we estimate is that luxury over the next 5 years is going to be low single-digit growth. However, the online business is going to go from 3% to 9% in 7 years. Actually, Bain estimates that 25% of luxury by 2025 will be online. That's a huge number. For you to understand, it's about $10 billion, and just at current rate, $2.5 billion will go online. So there's amazing potential.
So basically, the time is now if you want to launch a business.
I just want to add one thing to that. So just anecdotally, since I've invested in Mom's World, the company has grown 100% a year for the last 2 years. Okay, so that's phenomenal growth, right? And the other thing I want to mention is investors, I know you like to think that they're super smart and you know they're very well read and all that, but at the end of the day, there is a herd mentality, okay? So the best thing that can happen to the fashion industry is we get one great sort of brand or designer that builds a great business here, you'll see money flooding into the sector. And I think you know that well more than anyone. The minute they see other investors succeeding, frankly, a lot of other investors just jump in without much thought. That's the way it is globally. So right now, it's a great time because people believe in these businesses. They see the growth. They see the potential. Amazon's acquisition of Souq is amazing for us in the region because it sort of validated that there is a story here. And Amazon saw the same thing that Kunal is talking about, right? It's going from 2-3% to 20%, right, in the next 5 years. And again, you've heard the saying, you know, when there's rising tide, it lifts all ships. This is a rising tide. So you don't have to be a genius to sort of say one of these or a few of these businesses are going to end up doing really well. And I think that's what everybody's seeing right now in the online space.
Another question in the back.
Hello. Yeah. So hi. Thank you very much for coming here and for answering everyone's questions. And I think that the talk has been quite insightful so far. I just had one question, and I think it was referring to your initial slide, Amjad. And it was with regards to the matrix which you had with like low price, high price, young client, older client, etc. And it was just basically that like, yeah, I see that the sort of online e-commerce space is growing. And like with Souq, Noon, eLabels, Namshi, etc., they've been noticing phenomenal growth. I completely understand that. But then if you look at them, they've all been targeting a particular price range and a particular customer segment. Now, with those things, I've always wondered whether every industry is capable to go online or not, or is there some sort of boundary where something which is sort of in the luxury range, no pun intended, like in the sense of like a dress which is selling for, let's say, $700-$800, would someone buy that online, or would they prefer to kind of go and actually physically try it on? Where does the line go? What are the processes that we can make to make that transition easy? Is that scalable?
Yeah.
So the question is, when it comes to luxury items, how do you know if it suits online sales, basically, right? And is that scalable?
Yeah. And how can we make it scalable if it can be done?
I think it's a really timely question, actually, especially with Unas that just launched, and they have such expensive items, and it's growing so quickly. But you go ahead.
So this is why Precinct does not only invest in online businesses. We invest in offline businesses as well, because I'm a big believer that the worlds are colliding. You know, you're not going to have online business and offline business. You're going to have to be sort of 360. You're going to have to be omnipresent and omnichannel. And the first wave you saw was online businesses. And now what you're seeing is online buying offline, Amazon buying Whole Foods. And you're seeing, you know, offline businesses buying online businesses, right? So the worlds are colliding. I'll give you the example of Warby Parker, okay? So Warby hit $150 million in sales very quickly. By who? By the early adopters, people who are willing to buy online. Because it's a pair of glasses, right? So you want to see what it looks like on your face. Not so many people are willing to buy them online. So when they started hitting that ceiling, they decided to open up stores. So Warby now has stores in major urban areas, and those stores per square foot make more money than Tiffany. Okay? So this is a great online business that hit a ceiling and said, okay, now we need customers to walk in, try the glasses on, and adopt this. And they did a phenomenal job. And if you ever get a chance, you should go to one. It's like an Apple store for glasses. But so the worlds are colliding. Not everything will be sold online. I mean, I think some things you do need to try. Now, not to think way ahead, but we have to. Virtual reality is coming in, augmented reality. There are going to be ways, and I know for a fact that people are working on ways where in your own house with a camera, they'll be able to sort of design clothes for you. Amazon is working on a bespoke division where from the comfort of your own home, they'll take all your measurements, and then you'll get a t-shirt that fits you perfectly.
It's really amazing. We're finding fewer reasons to leave our house.
It will get there. But I think the offline will have to adapt. So I think it's a great question. And you will see very creative models come into play now as we go forward.
So just to add to that, we're over $600 in average basket. And 45% of our orders come on an app. And 30%.
Wow, that's really high.
Yes, very good number. And 30% of our UAE sales are click and collect. So it's a...
I think that's both really good examples. I think we have time for one more question. Go ahead.
Hi. My question is about fashion designers, not just online boutiques. The dynamics are different than an online boutique. So for a fashion designer to be able to make it to two or three seasons, they have specific expenses, like going to shows such as Fashion Forward or going to many shows in Europe and the States. So before even being recognized or being seen by buyers or just being on the map in any of those fashion capitals, they have at least per season 10 to 20, and this is the minimum, without travel expenses, without having a team. So how much are investors willing to wait? Because to be able to get results, they need at least 2 to 3 seasons, which is 1.5 years, more or less. So how willing are the investors to wait that much and believe, or because it's a completely different system than an online business or an online boutique per se. So, and I've seen that through my business that I had and through other designers who are facing this problem and not convincing investors, but trying to understand each other into, because they need this investment. Otherwise, even if they're the most genius or the most creative designers, they won't be able to get anywhere if they're not exposed.
Yeah, understood. So it's just a very unique question, very niche, related to how designers can get the right educated investor, I guess.
So I actually don't see that very different than businesses that we see, to be honest with you. I think it's how you articulate your need, right? So in the seed stage, and actually even in venture, this happens, I think, more outside than in this region. I think the investors here are very harsh in terms of wanting to see like revenue from day one. But you know, there are businesses that don't have any revenues for a very long time, but you believe in the traction that they're making. So I think it's all about telling the investor that this is my industry and this is what's needed for me to actually lay those seeds. And I'll tell you, there are a lot of businesses that you probably know of in the region that don't have revenues yet. You've probably heard of them, or their revenues are fairly very small. But the investors believe in the business, and they believe that they're going to get traction. So the question I would have for you is, okay, I'm going to let you spend $200,000 for the next 2 years, right? How will you prove traction to me, right? So traction doesn't always mean revenue. It can mean other things. They are. So, yeah. Yes. Yes.
It's about patient capital, right?
Yeah, it's about patient capital. It's about people who understand the fashion industry, understand that it's going to take time. By the way, I don't know if you guys know this, but we don't invest for 2-3 years. I mean, when I decide Luxury Closet, and we discussed this the first time we met, this is like 10-15 year thought process. This is not 2-3 years.
An average for a VC, I think, is a fund lifetime is 7 years.
Yeah, that's what they say, but it actually historically it's 14 years for a venture fund, okay? So I'll give you my private equity days. We were investing in mature companies and our fund life was 11 years. So these are long-term investments. Now,
I think that's pretty standard, though, in private equity. So
yeah, I think private equity eventually.
When you're
know.
At a kind of earlier stage, yes. Maybe it's a little bit different than that.
But I
just
the,
get
the
a good
appetite
rich
question,
friend. That's my advice.
Sorry, just the appetite question. This is why I think you have to be careful with who you target. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of very specific fashion investors here, but globally you do. You have private equity groups, venture capital groups that focus only on fashion. Those are the best people to go to because they understand the industry. Right. Right. Exactly.
Maybe that's your next business idea then. Do a fashion VC.
But also don't put all your hope in like finding like this dream investor who's going to come and cut you off this $5 million check and then you'll hire all these people, and you know, like that movie that I saw where the ladies, Anne Hathaway, cycling through the office, and I don't have a cycle in my office. we need to budget for that stuff.
So can I just mention one quick example? I have one small investment in the US. It's called Snow Home, okay? Please go to the website. It's a great little brand, and it's a brand. It's a home essentials brand, okay? So they're building it from scratch, okay? And the makeup of the investors are actually 90% luxury executives. So they're all people from like Louis Vuitton, you know, the industry, fashion industry, and they just believe in the concept. And these guys talk to everybody. I mean, they're lucky they're in New York, but they ended up talking to anyone that they could speak to in the fashion industry, and they ended up raising about $3 million. So I think you have to cast a wide net.
I think that's all the time we have, but I hope that you found it educational and as interesting as I still do after years of reporting on this topic. It's such an honor to share the stage with both of you. And
you
are an amazing audience for coming on a Friday evening and listening to a PowerPoint and coming up with really insightful questions. So round of applause to you, and thank you so much for your time. And here's to someone in the audience making enough money to have their own 300 Hermes scarves that they can sell sometime. Let's do a selfie from the stage.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.